हेलो नमस्ते आदाब वेलकम टू एट अनदर एडिशन ऑफ लिटरेरी गुरु इन टुडेज स्पेशल एडिशन वी हैव विद अस श्री शशि तरूर एमिनेंट ऑथर फॉर्मर अंडर सेक्रेटरी जनरल ऑफ द यूनाइटेड नेशंस ऑर्गेनाइजेशन फॉर्मर यूनियन मिनिस्टर ऑफ स्टेट फॉर ह्यूमन रिसोर्स डेवलपमेंट एंड एक्सटर्नल अफेयर्स एंड नाउ ऑफ कोर्स द चेयरमैन ऑफ पार्लियामेंट्री स्टैंडिंग कमिटी ऑन इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी
It's a privilege to have you in our program, Literary Guru, sir. You are our special Literary Guru today.
Thank you.
You are a writer, diplomat, and whatnot, an activist and everything. Looking back your literary career, sir, you wrote at a very early age of 6 years.
Yes. You know, I was an asthmatic child. In fact, I was born in London, but when my parents moved back to India, at the age of about 2.5, I started developing asthma. Okay. And it became worse initially. It got to a point where one really was struggling to breathe a lot of the time. And you know, the problem in those days, there were no inhalers and so on. So you just had to take strong medication. Your heart would pump and beat away and you wouldn't be able to sleep. So I was awake a lot. And during that time, what could I do? There was no television in India in those days. There was no Nintendo, no mobile phones, no computers. All there were books. So books were my entertainment, my escape, my education.
Yeah.
And I read a lot. And when I ran out of books to read, I started to write also. I said, may as well, because words and books were my entire life at that time. And I have to say that looking back on it, I really am grateful to my parents for the encouragement they gave me. My father didn't just dismiss these as the, you know, scribblings of an asthmatic child. He got them typed up by his secretary so that I could show them to friends and so on. It became I began to take myself seriously as a writer in that manner. And I must say that over the years, that's been something that has always mattered to me. It's been very much part of my instinct. And I first started writing stories very much like the stories I was reading around the age of 6. And then a story was published when I was 10 years old. And that, I think, was the beginning of my literary career, if you want to call it that.
Who was your inspiration, sir? Your favorite writer, author, whoever it is?
Well, you know, as a child, you know, going to English medium schools and so on, you read English books, and inevitably, like almost every other child of my generation, there were 3 or 4 favorites. Enid Blyton is very well known. I began discovering stories from my mother reading aloud the Noddy books when I was a small child. And my mother always jokes that she read them so badly, I had to snatch the books from her to read them myself. And that's why I started reading so early. I was reading before I was 3 years old, 2, 2.5. And Ian Blyton, of course, carries you right through into your early teens, because there are stories for different age groups. Yeah. And, you know, when you're really young, you can read the Noddy books when you're really young, and then the fairy tale books, and then the adventure. Then come the Secret Seven, and so on, and the 5 Fine Doubters. Then come the Famous 5, and then the adventure books, and so on. By the time you run out of Enid Blyton's to read, you're about 13 or 14. In parallel, I read the very sort of male pleasures of the Biggles books. Biggles was a British flying ace in World War I, whose adventures carried on through World War II and beyond into the Cold War. And I read those with a lot of pleasure and excitement, very typically male. Then there were the Billy Bunter books of Frank Richards and the William books of Richmond Crompton, which gave me an abiding fondness for humor. Both of those, in very different ways, were funny, cleverly plotted, very imaginative, and totally pleasurable. Richmond Crompton's humor in many ways prepared me for later adult writers like P.G. Woodhouse, who became my favorite. I first heard an extract from a Woodhouse book when I was taking dictation in English class in school at the age of 11, and I was not worried about the spellings, but I started laughing while the teacher was dictating. And at the end of the lesson, I went to the teacher and said, "Where was this from?" And he said it was a book called The Indiscretions of Archie by P.G. Woodhouse. So I promptly went to the school library, and fortunately it was there.
Yeah.
And from then onwards, I read every single one of Woodhouse's 95 books. 95 books he wrote.
And Jeeves is irrepressible.
Jeeves and Wooster, the Blandings Castle ones, even funnier. And some of the individual ones, which were not with recurrent characters, were also incredibly good. Amongst the Blandings books, Leave It to Smith is a masterpiece. But there are others, you know, Hot Water, Heavy Weather, Summer Lightning, the extraordinary thing about it is it's so intricately plotted, and yet so light and diverting, and the writing is top class. You know, the subversion, the playful subversion of the English language, I think was really a joy. And I developed my sense of humor in many ways, starting with the William books of Richmond Crompton, going on through the Woodhouse books. And after I finished finished every Woodhouse book in print, it was very difficult to find a writer who would match. I kept looking for others, Richard Gordon, Henry Cecil, Tom Sharp, and so on, but no one came close. And that's the true hat tip to the master, is that nobody could match him. But then, of course, the more serious reading started. And by my late teens, I had read John Updike in America, Philip Roth, in Britain, Graham Greene, Somerset Maugham. Then in translated novels from world literature.
Yeah.
Latin America had Gabriel Garcia Marquez, Octavio Paz, and Mario Vargas Llosa. And Eastern Europe had a writer like Milan Kundera, who was truly remarkable. And in those days, much more than today, our newspapers had space to write about books.
Yeah.
And because of that, I discovered books through reading Indian newspapers.
Yeah.
So how would I know about Milan Kundera? Because there was some there was a retired IRS official called Iqbal Masood, who would write reviews
in the
Bombay papers, and all over the place. And it was, he had a high standard in reading, and through his reading, I discovered there were all these writers you could discover. And then, the Indian writer, Salman Rushdie.
Mm.
I was in Singapore with the United Nations, heading the office of the UN High Commissioner for Refugees there, when Midnight's Children came out. And I was invited to review it for the Straits Times. And I was so astonished by the book. I called it The Great Indian Novel. And amusingly enough, a title that I subsequently appropriated for my own work. But I meant it in his case. It really is, I think, a great Indian novel.
Sir, we know you are fond of Hindi films a lot and wish to play some of your favorite songs. And Kishore Da happens to be your favorite singer, I think. Maybe you can play a beautiful song of Kishore Da.
Ye Shaam Mastani is another Kishore Kumar song.
Ye Shaam Mastani Madhosh kiye jaye Mujhe door koi khinche Teri or liye jaye Ye Shaam Mastani मदहोश किए जा मुझे डोर कोई खींचे तेरी ओर लिए जा के तू हंस के जहर कोई पिए जाए शाम मस्तानी मदहोश किए जा मुझे डोर कोई खींचे तेरी ओर लिए जा जब मैं करूं मुझे रोक देती है चूं तेरी नीची नजर मुझे टोक देती है क्यों तेरी हया तेरी शर्म तेरी कसम मेरे होठ सिए जाए शाम मस्तानी मदहोश किए जा मुझे डोर कोई खींचे तेरी ओर लिए जा जैसे कोई खामोश ऐसे है तू तस्वीर जैसे कोई तेरी नजर बन के जुबान लेकिन तेरे पैगाम दिए जाए शाम मस्तानी मदहोश किए जा मुझे डोर कोई खींचे तेरी ओर दिए जाए ये शाम मस्तानी मदहोश किए जाए मुझे डोर कोई खींचे तेरी ओर लिए जाए
Welcome back. In today's Literary Guru program, we have with us special guest C. Shashi Tharoorji, eminent author and chairman Parliamentary Standing Committee on Information Technology.
You yourself are a great novelist and non-fiction writer, plus a great columnist. Sunday with Shashi, Hindu, nobody can forget that.
Oh, nice of you. Yes, I did write for many years in the Hindu and then for some years in the Times of India. And what people have forgotten is that before that, in the 90s, I had a column in the Indian Express.
Yeah.
So I've actually been in the three major papers as a columnist. And what was unusual is that I was doing it from abroad.
Yeah.
I wasn't yet back in India. All these three columns were written when I was based in New York and traveling around the world for the UN. But I'm very gratified to still come across people who remember them. Particularly, I think the Hindu column developed a very loyal readership.
We remember you were turning 50 in that column.
There you are. Yes, I turned 50 when I wrote that. And interesting that people remember. I mean, maybe because South Indian newspaper readers take their newspapers more seriously, I don't know. But I still come across people who say they used to cut my articles out and keep them, keep the clippings to reread them. And so very, very fascinating. Yeah, I enjoy reading, I enjoy writing for an audience.
Yeah.
In other words, as a writer, you want to be read. When you write a book, it takes an enormous amount of time and effort, and you have no idea how many people are going to read it, if any at all. Whereas with a column, it's very short. Normally, 1,000 words is about the optimum. It takes you at most a couple of hours to write. You're making one point usually, or sometimes it's more discursive, but most of the time it's a straightforward argument. And then it's in the newspaper, and if you're living in the same country or city where the newspaper appears, then you even meet people who've read it. Yes. So that gives you instant feedback.
Yeah.
Of course, that last point I couldn't benefit from when I was sitting in the UN.
Yeah.
But certainly growing up as a writer in India, there is no doubt for me that getting audience feedback was very much part of what shaped me as a writer. Because I was there in Bombay, Calcutta, and then Delhi, publishing in pretty much every Indian magazine in my teenage years. And obviously getting real-time feedback from the audiences that I was writing for, which meant that I could see what was working, what was appreciated, what was not so much appreciated, and so on. And that's how you... I always believe that most things you get better by doing, not by theory. So that if you want to be a good speaker, go out and speak. Maybe your first few speeches won't be very good. And from the audience, we actually will understand what works and what kind of...
And you're also a great speaker, sir. You deliver lectures at ISB and various other places, IITs and IIMs. How does that feel?
No, I think it's all part of the need for self-expression. The thing about writing is that reading is a demanding thing. And for many people now, it's becoming less and less common. It's very nice to meet your colleagues who are reading my books, but I know that for the most part, many, many people find it much easier to sit back and switch on the TV than to read. I mean, let's be very honest. That is what humanity has...
And does it bother you?
It bothers me. It bothers me to a great extent, but I will also admit that that this is understandable, that human beings are constantly evolving as a species. When I grew up with books, I had no other distractions. When my children were growing up, they had all these distractions, but fortunately, whether one can take any credit for it or it's merely genes or whatever, they have a tremendous fondness and respect for words and writing and reading. Now, when their children grow up, is that still going to be there? I don't know. I certainly hope so. You know, in my case, my father was a newspaper executive. So not only books, but newspapers were very much a part of my life. I remember every morning from the age of about six, you know, sitting with him and his newspapers in the morning chai. When we were in Bombay, I think it was six newspapers. In Calcutta, it was four. And then in the evening, he would come back home with the newspapers from everywhere else in the country. In those days, you know, you couldn't get them instantly, but they were flown in and you would see them in the evening. So the result was that I already got a sense of what was happening in the country and in the world from a very young age, and the habit of being interested in that. Similarly, when it came to books, it was still an era where books offered a lot more than any other diversion. Yeah. And yes, it started off with me being a very badly asthmatic child, unable to go out and play with my friends, and therefore books were the only option. Yes, but when you really got stuck into them, they become a source of pleasure, diversion, and so on all the time. So I can't, you know, even today, I can't imagine taking a flight without a book in my bag. Yeah. That's the way I am. I hope that even if we acknowledge that the reading of books is going to be a minority taste, let us hope it's a robust enough minority to be able to sustain a publishing industry, because without publishers, writers have no means of reaching the audience.
But still, sir, in India, still English language has considerable number of followers or readers.
Yes and no.
The colloquial languages, the regional languages.
There's been a rough estimate that up to 200 million people in India have some sort of nodding familiarity with the English language. Out of those 200 million, I would say at least half are only really using the language for office purposes.
Yes, sir.
That is, they'll think in English, they'll speak at home. I mean, they'll think in their mother tongue, they'll speak at home in their mother tongue. They will be at the bus stop in their mother tongue, whatever. They'll watch television in their mother tongue. But when they go to the office, they will write what the British used to call Babu English. They'll write, you know, memoranda or official correspondence, whatever. And that's all the English is. So you can't count them, because they will never, if they're going to read a book, they'll read in their mother tongue. If they're going to see a movie, they'll see it in their mother tongue and so on. It will not be English. So that half the population has gone there. Of the remaining 100 million, I would say that there is a reasonable possibility that half of those are simply too busy, too bothered to read anything for pleasure. I know a lot of people, well-educated people, so it's not a language problem. But for them, they say, you know, I have a long day of work, come back, who's going to pick up a book? And that's another half gone. Of the remaining half, the youngsters of the present generation, let's say the under-18s today, I would say it's a small minority in that half who read. And that worries me, because I have friends whose children have associated reading only with homework. For them, reading is something you do to finish your homework and write an exam. There is no concept of reading beyond the school. And when I explain to people that people like me read for pleasure, for fun, for amusement, they look at me with incomprehension because their pleasure comes from a handheld game or a mobile thing or or a Nintendo or a computer or a TV. It doesn't come from dull pages of text on a book. And that worries me a lot because if you start losing that generation or large chunks of it, where do you go? And yes, I feel some optimism because I'm amazed by the number of young people who are still writing. Every week I'll get at least 4 or 5 letters from some young kid who has written a quote-unquote book which the parents have spent money self-publishing. But at least, you know, that aspiration is still there is for me a big relief.
Sir, time to play back one of your favorite songs again. Maybe you can play one more Kishore Das song.
फूलों के रंग से दिल की कलम से तुझको लिखी रोज पाती कैसे बताऊं किस किस तरह से पल पल मुझे तू सताती तेरे ही सपने लेकर के सोया तेरी ही यादों में जागा तेरे ख्यालों में उलझा रहा हूँ जैसे कि माला में धागा हाँ बादल बिजली चंदन पानी जैसा अपना प्यार लेना होगा जन्म हमें कई कई बार इतना मधुर तेरा मेरा प्यार लेना होगा जन्म हमें कई कई बार सांसों की सरगम धड़कन की बीना सपनों की गीतांजलि तू मन की गली में महके जो हरदम ऐसी जूही की कली तू छोटा सफर हो लंबा सफर हो सुनी डगर हो या मेला या तू आए मन हो जाए भीड़ के बीच अकेला हाँ बादल बिजली चंदन पानी जैसा अपना प्यार लेना होगा जन्म हमें कई कई बार इतना मधुर तेरा मेरा प्यार लेना होगा जन्म हमें कई कई बार हो पश्चिम उत्तर हो दक्षिण तू हर जगह मुस्कुराए जितना ही जाऊं मैं दूर तुझसे उतनी ही तू पास आए आंधी ने रोका पानी ने टोका दुनिया ने हंसकर पुकारा तस्वीर तेरी लेकिन लिए मैं कर आया सबसे किनारा हाँ बात
खुजली चंदन पानी जैसा अपना प्यार लेना होगा जन्म हमें कई कई बार हाँ इतना मधुर इतना मधुर तेरा मेरा प्यार लेना होगा जन्म हमें कई कई बार कई कई बार।
वेलकम बैक टू लिटरेरी गुरु। इन टुडेस लिटरेरी गुरु वी हैव विद अस श्री शशि तरूर, eminent author and chairman parliamentary standing committee on information technology.
So you've been contemporary in your writings. The latest book, The Battle of Belonging, and you always defend motherland, like the great Indian novelist Why I'm a Hindu. The Battle of Belonging, you have taken a little deflection of your...
No, The Battle of Belonging is, first of all, the first 100 pages are a study, almost a theoretical study of nationalism and patriotism and so on. And then I apply it to our own reality, and I explain how our nationalist movement did not divide on geography. It wasn't North versus South. It didn't divide on ideology. It wasn't Marxist versus capitalist. It was on one simple principle: should religion be the determinant of our nationhood? And those who said that their religion determined their national identity, they went off and created a country called Pakistan. And those who remained, from Mahatma Gandhi, Nehruji, Radhakrishnan, Rajendra Prasad, Maulana Azad, Sardar Patel, Dr. Ambedkar, they all consistently took the view that our freedom struggle has been for everybody and the country we create will be for everybody. And as a result, they wrote a constitution which has created the India we know and have known for the last 75 years. In that process, there's an implicit idea of India, a land of equal opportunity, land of democracy, land of where it doesn't matter what your religion is, your caste is, your color is, your language is, your place of birth is. All of that is irrelevant. If you're an Indian citizen, you have the same rights as every other Indian citizen. That idea is very fundamental. So the book in many ways describes this idea. It's in nationalist discourse, it would be called civic nationalism, as opposed to nationalism based on religion, or nationalism based on language, or nationalism based on ethnicity, all of which have existed in recent history in other places. For us, our nationalism is a civic nationalism anchored in the Constitution and sustained by democratic institutions. So that's the thesis and argument of the book. But this book is, to me, rather important in order to ensure that as far as young people who are proud of Indian nationalism and Indian patriotism are concerned, that they should understand the content of India's nationalism and patriotism. What is it about? What does it mean? What is it full of?
Thank you, sir. And how do you manage time, sir? You are a globetrotter and we see you juggling too many activities and you're terribly busy.
I'm afraid that's my biggest challenge. You know, first of all, I write, as George Bernard Shaw famously said, I write for the same reason a cow gives milk. It's inside me, it's got to come out. So, and a cow would be in real pain if you didn't milk her, and if I didn't write, I would be in real pain too, psychologically. So I need to write. But having said that, I've been in demanding professions all my life.
Yeah.
I had very interesting and challenging jobs at the UN and now in Indian politics. And as a result of that, I haven't had a chance to do full justice, perhaps, to my own literary ideas and dreams and the things I want to write and do. One reviewer in the Washington Post of one of my books said, if only this chap would give up his day job, what a great writer he would be. It was very kind of him, but at that point my day job was the UN and it mattered to me. And here today my day job not only matters to me, but it's also something where I believe I have earned the trust of my voters and I can't let them down. So I always make it very clear to my staff and everybody else, yes, I want to carve out the time to write, but work is always priority and you can interrupt me whenever there is an urgent call from the constituency or any important matter, some minister wants a meeting, whatever, you just have to put that first. There's no question that writing comes afterwards. But otherwise, I write whenever I can. I write on planes, I write at home, I write at night. You know, for a politician, there's no weekend. Every seven days a week is the same. So whenever you find the time, often, I would say most common is late at night. Mm. When I was young, I was not a late night person. I was an early morning person. But I find that it's really from 11 o'clock that the phone stops ringing and people stop dropping in unannounced. And, you know, you suddenly have time to yourself where you know you'll have a clear stretch of a couple of hours, no one bothering you, at night. So a lot of my writing now is at night. But I will admit one thing, that as you rightly said at the beginning, I've written a lot of novels and fiction at the beginning, four books of fiction. But thereafter, I haven't. And why have I not? Very simply because every time I began a novel, it got interrupted. And you know, with fiction, unlike non-fiction, you need not only time, which is scarce enough, but you need a space inside your head to create an alternative universe and to populate it with situations, characters, lines of dialogue that are as real to you as those of what you encounter in daily life.
Yeah.
Now, that is not available to you. You're building this glass palace of illusion. But if the glass keeps getting shattered, you can't keep rebuilding it. So, you know, I create some characters in my mind, create a storyline in my mind, start writing. Mm. And then something comes along and I suddenly have to rush off the constituency, or I've got to go campaign somewhere, or I have to go and, you know, whatever it may be that distracts you as a politician.
It is the time that's the villain.
And then when you come back, you find it very difficult to pick up the threads, get back into the mood of that world. You know, with non-fiction, I have the same challenges of time.
Yeah. And but with non-fiction, you do a lot of research in your
life. So with non-fiction, what happens is you know what you're writing much better than with fiction. Fiction, a certain spontaneity, a certain evolution has to happen. With non-fiction, you write something, you're interrupted. Even if you come back 1 week later and reread what you've written, you'll remember the argument you were coming to and you can develop it. Certainly with the research that I've needed for my last few books, the material is there. It's not going to disappear merely because I was interrupted. So I come back, if necessary, reread the material, pick up the threads. That's not so much of a problem. Each of my books has been very different in terms of, I mean, not in terms of style because it's still the same writer, but in terms of the kind of theme, treatment, the way the book has unfolded. And that is one of the
things. Many of your books are reprinted again and again, sir.
Touch wood, yes. Touch wood, I'm pleased about that.
Muhammad Rafi Saab, also your favorite singer, sir. Maybe you can play one of Rafi Saab's songs for you.
Ehsaan tera ho ya mujh
ehsaan tera ho ga mujh par dil chahta hai wo kehne do mujhe tumse mohabbat ho gayi hai mujhe palkon ki chhaon mein rehne do एहसान तेरा हो गा मुझ पर दिल चाहता है वो कहने दो मुझे तुमसे मोहब्बत हो गई है मुझे पलकों की छांव में रहने दो एहसान तेरा हो गा मुझ पर बना दो चाहे मिटा दो मर भी गए तो देंगे दुआ, उड़ उड़ के कहेगी खाक सना ये दर्द मोहब्बत, सहने दो मुझे तुमसे मोहब्बत हो गई है मुझे पलकों की छांव, रहने दो एहसान तेरा होगा मुझ पर दिल चाहता है वो, कहने दो मुझे तुमसे मोहब्बत हो गई है मुझे पलकों की छांव, रहने दो एहसान तेरा होगा मुझ पर।
Welcome back to Literary Guru. In today's Literary Guru, we have with us Sri Shashi Tharoor, eminent author and chairman parliamentary standing committee on information technology.
Finally, one last question, sir. How do you look at today's contemporary fiction?
Well, today's literary scene is very healthy, considering what we talked about earlier, that the readership may be dwindling. But the writers, I think, are in very good shape. And what is more, they're getting a lot more international, national and international recognition. National because the quality of translations is improving dramatically. When I was a kid, we had terrible translations of Hindi, Malayalam, Bengali books into English. So that someone like me who couldn't read in those languages was dependent on really poor translations and you never felt enthusiastic. Today, the translations are so good. By and large, that you can actually enjoy reading a book from another language, and that also expands your repertoire. And similarly, foreigners can enjoy it too.
Yeah.
You know, a novel in Kannada may never have attracted the attention of a publisher in Canada, Kannada and Canada, but the fact is that today it would, because that Canadian publisher will probably read a very good English language translation and say, wow, this sounds good. Telugu writing, I'm not as familiar with as I should be, but the same logic applies right across the board.
We hear you also like a lot of duets, sir. Maybe you can play a duet song for you, perhaps.
One of my favorite duets is "Acha Toh Ham Chalte."
Acha Toh Ham Chalte. अच्छा तो हम चलते हैं,
फिर कब मिलोगे?
जब तुम कहोगे
जुम्मे रात को।
हाँ हाँ आधी रात को।
कहाँ?
वही जहाँ कोई आता जाता नहीं, वही जहाँ कोई आता जाता नहीं। अच्छा तो हम चलते।
देखा तो नहीं तुम्हें आते?
नहीं मैं आई हूँ छुपते छुपाते।
देर कर दी बड़ी, जरा देखो तो घड़ी।
ओहो मेरी तो घड़ी बंद है।
तेरी ये अदा मुझे पसंद है।
देखो बातें बातें कर लो जल्दी जल्दी, फिर ना कहना अभी आई अभी चल दी।
तो आओ पास बैठे पल दो पल,
आज नहीं कल।
क्यों क्यों?
आज नहीं कल,
ये तो एक बहाना है,
वापस घर भी जाना है।
कितनी जल्दी ये दिन ढलते हैं। हाय
टाटा। अच्छा तो हम चलते हैं,
फिर कब मिलोगे?
जब तुम कहोगे।
कल मिलो या परसों?
परसों नहीं नरसों।
कहाँ?
यही यहाँ कोई आता जाता नहीं। अच्छा तो हम चलते हैं।
इसलिए तेरा रंग गोरी,
हमारी पकड़ी गई है बस चोरी।
अच्छा?
राम जाने क्या हुआ,
कैसे हुआ ये गजब।
मेरा चल जरा ढल गया, सारी दुनिया को पता चल गया।
कैसे खेलेंगे अब आंख मिचोली,
ले जा आके मेरे घर से मेरी डोली।
तेरे घर वाले न कर दे इनकार,
सब है तैयार सब है तैयार।
सुन ले फिर दिल की फरियाद,
बस बाकी शादी के बाद। पिया देखो दिए जलते हैं।
अच्छा अच्छा तो हम चलते हैं,
अच्छा तो हम चलते हैं, अच्छा तो हम चलते हैं, अच्छा तो हम चलते हैं, अच्छा तो हम चलते हैं।
What is your advice to the aspiring writers?
Honestly, I tell everyone who wants to be a writer that the only way to find out if you're any good is by writing. So just write. Don't go and ask anyone to tell you how to write, because if you need to be told how to write, then you're not a writer. Then don't waste your time. Go and do something else. But if you are an instinctive writer, write. And I must say to all writers, read. Because without reading, you'll never know what good writing is. So if you read, and then you go ahead and you write, your writing will have much greater value.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure, sir.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your wonderful and valuable experiences on books and also on your writing career. It was a pleasure for all our listeners to listen to your cherished memories. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.